we are the last men standing between you and Vivek Oberoi. So that's not me. That's Imran, who couldn't make it. It's a much better looking person. So what you got instead is a fat bald man. But let's try and make it interesting. What we have is four entrepreneurs who are building very interesting businesses in what's called the early learning daycare, childcare space. And what I want to do is, over the next 30-35 minutes that we have, try and give you a flavor of the interesting things that are happening in early stage business and the innovations that they're doing to really drive growth. So the way we're going to structure it is, I'm going to give you each two minutes, okay? Introduce yourself, talk a little bit about the business, what you do, like in an elevator pitch fashion, and tell us about the one outcome, one learning outcome, because our topic is about learning outcomes, one outcome that your business is being built for. So I think you are Mike, if you want. So Vish, you go first.
Thanks, Ajit. Let me actually start by wishing everyone out here a very happy Teacher's Day. So I'm co-founder and CEO of Magic Crate. Now, I have other gentlemen here who run preschool chains. But if you think about it, the child spends almost double the time at home as it does at school during the first few years of its life, right? Now, combine that with the fact that 80% of who you become gets determined in the first 8 years of your life. There is a large opportunity for us to use an at-home setting and use play as a methodology to help build skills in children. So that's what we do at Magic Crate. So we use the science of learning. We combine that with the power of play to drive very important outcomes, educational outcomes for children. I hope I made that 2 minutes.
Is there a specific outcome, like learning through learning through play or something? Do you have a phrase for it?
Sure. So let me actually break it down into two different categories. Yeah. So I'm going to break that down into 0 to 8 years.
Okay.
And then 8 years to 12 years.
Okay.
So 0 to 8 years, the focus is on allowing children to build. There are 7 broad goals that any curricular framework kind of lays out. Mm-hmm. So we hit that through play experiences.
Got it.
And primarily physical in nature. Got it. Right? And for children who are older than that, we enable 3 things. We enable children to build conceptual clarity, which enables them to do better at school. We help build skills like critical thinking, problem solving, which schools are not designed to solve. And we do this in a way that the child looks forward to.
Got right?
So unlike something that the child sees as being imposed on the child, be it a tuition class, be it an app, this is something that the child hopefully looks forward to and learns from it.
Got it. Fair enough. Let's move on to Purvesh.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Purvesh, and I represent Footprints Childcare. We are a chain of preschool and daycare centers with over 80-plus operational centers. And the outcome that we are wanting to fulfill is nurturing happiness and freedom in children.
Nurturing
happiness and freedom in children. And using a research-based scientific curriculum which is well-tested, tried, mostly in the Western world, and bringing that to India.
Got it. Great stuff. Yeah. AK.
Thank you. My name is Shrikant. I am the COO at Clay. We are a group of integrated preschools, play schools, and we operate about 150 centers across the country. We do not franchise. They are all company-owned, company-operated. And I think Priya Krishnan, who's the founder and CEO of the company, when she started this, her vision was to enable women to get back to work guilt-free. And that was the point from which Clay Schools started off in India. So obviously, apart from having a world-class curriculum in place, we also have a lot of emphasis on the health, safety, and those aspects of the child, along with the other parameters that are commonly associated with preschools or play schools.
Hite.
Hi. My name is Hitendra Merchant. I'm the founder and CEO of Yoboho. We've got multiple brands like Hoopla Kids, which is one of the largest preschool brands on YouTube. Along with that, we've got All Babies Channel and other multiple brands. Our job, our focus is to entertain, educate, and engage the kids, make sure that we build an IP which could then move on to other platforms.
Yeah, great. Thank you for sticking to the two-minute limit. So I just want to, the two of you, Clay and Footprints, Purvesh and AK, who are focused on the in-school or in a facility experience, and the rest of you are at home. I mean, you're off screen, he's on screen, though you do have screen in the 8 to 12 thing. So we'll talk to the two of you a little later. But I want to just talk to the two of you, and I found it really interesting. So the outcome that, Purvesh, you're building for is nurturing happiness and freedom. Lovely words. You're building for something more practical, trust and safety, through lots of cameras and all that, I'm sure. But I just want to kind of understand, how have you structured your business model? And I know there are differences between the two of you, like you have all company owned, whereas yours is largely franchise. So I want to just take a step back a little bit. How did you build out the business model? And are there any specific innovations you have built to deliver on this outcome? And how do you, and are, is there any North Star metric you track to kind of like measure, like trust and safety? Is there a specific metric that you track, X number of incidents or no incidents, et cetera?
Very interesting, you know. The one thing I would say that we are trying to innovate is using technology to create an ecosystem which connects parents and, of course, teaching community, which wants to do that, and passionate women entrepreneurs mostly who want to, you know, contribute in this field.
Got it.
Which are otherwise very difficult to attract by education industry. Unfortunately, it doesn't pay well.
Doesn't pay well.
I think that's pretty much known in this room, that, you know, a preschool teacher is, I think, the least paid teacher, and the kind of pay scales which are there in India are pathetically low.
Are you looking to change that?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think we're looking to change that. Of course, Clay is also changing that. But by far, if you see, the talent that especially preschool industry attracts in terms of teaching is not of very high quality. Very difficult to track that. Most people would prefer a corporate job. So we are trying to create an ecosystem where people are passionate, it works for them, they can express their passion, and it is practical.
So you're saying the best way to deliver on the outcome is to get great teachers, passionate teachers, who want to kind of give back, etc., right?
Okay. And women entrepreneurs, you know, who want to do that. They can do that. And in terms of parents, we have brought in, you know, CCTV cameras, where we are broadcast live feed to all the parents. And through our app, we give real-time updates to all the parents, you know, what, when, how much your child ate, slept, played. Because that is what a young mother or young, you know, parent is continuously wanting to know till the child is about 3, 4, 5 years of age.
Got it.
So that builds the basic trust between us and the parent to, you know, get the child. And third is, you know, the curriculum. One thing we realized early on in Footprints is that, you know, we are not experts of child brain development. Research is happening, especially mostly abroad, in Harvard, Stanford, in top universities on child brain development. And they have developed practices. Curriculums have been developed specifically for preschool, first 5 years, for last 70 years.
Yeah.
We want to build those practices to India.
Got it.
And integrate these three.
Got it. Fair enough. AK, Shrikant. Yeah.
The way we look at this is, while we could have, and we do have CCTV streaming and updates and all of that, but what we realized is that the best way to engage children and keep parents, you know, worry-free at their workplaces is to make sure that we have a certain happiness in the center. So one thing we do, and as he rightly mentioned, it's not the best paying industry to begin with. So the happy workplace concept, actually, we've just been rated amongst the great, you know, great places to work this year. So one thing we're very particular about is to have a happy sort of feel at the center. So the mantra goes like happy staff is equal to happy children, which is equal to happy parents. So what we find is that if there were two centers, one which is clinically run, no internet outages, perfectly run place with the discipline of a Singapore hospital, versus something that's run like you're in the neighborhood auntie's house, the parents actually stop looking at the CCTV beyond a certain time if they know their children are happy. If the children are crying to go back to see their auntie on a Saturday or a Sunday, then something is going right at the school.
Great.
I think we put a lot of emphasis on that part.
Yeah. So it's almost like you could have like a North Star metric which says how many times do parents check that app. If they're checking it frequently, that center is probably not such a great center. So I don't know, just thoughts. So great, so I want to get, just step back. I want to come back to you guys, but let's get Hiten and let's get Vishy. And so both of you have taken very different approaches, and you've trying to deliver it through screen predominantly, Hoopla Kids, lots of rhymes, sort of, and getting children to learn through fun, rhymes, videos, etc. And yours is more hands-on, doing, etc. So why did you choose these specifically, and how is it kind of like, and what were some of the decisions that took you to this?
And then maybe Hiten.
Sure. So if you look at the signs of learning, which is how each one of us learns, there are seven different learning styles that each one of us has, right? Now, some concepts lend themselves well to a certain learning style. Some concepts lend themselves well to a different learning style. And it's almost like your ability to build multiple learning styles, that's what makes you a lifelong learner. So think of this almost like you go to gym and you build great biceps, but the rest of your body is weak. That doesn't help you, right? So it's super important that you build on multiple learning styles. So therefore, hands-on exploration is a way of learning. Similarly, visual is a way of learning. So what we tend to do is we pick up concepts, we look at what is the best way to convey something, and then the learning kit is built around that. So it's not true to say that we are fully offline.
Yeah.
Yes, there is a large hands-on component that we have, but for older children, we also have a digital layer.
So is there any North Star metric that you track in your business to see are the learning outcomes being met? Like, is there some engagement factor? Because it's so offline, there's no way to get feedback. Like, he can get feedback on how many views, how long it is, etc.
Correct. No, it's very hard to track efficacy. Mm. At this stage of the company, we are a three-year-old company, but our North Star metric is efficacy, right? It's our ability to help that child build conceptual clarity.
So it's probably less churn. That could tell you whether the parents really like it, and so that is one factor.
So it's, NPS is one way to look at that.
Yeah.
Our renewal rates are other ways to kind of look at that. So both those numbers continue to be very high.
Terrific.
So that tells us that we are trended in the right direction.
Yeah.
But various things which have been touched upon in the previous panels also have been around how do you drive efficacy in education versus just efficiency, right?
Okay.
So we are constantly in search of how do we kind of get efficacy metrics out of this also, right? We have not yet solved it.
Not yet solved, okay.
So we've been in this business for over 10 years. So we actually started when YouTube was bought over by Google. And our first primary job was to actually get more views on the platform. What we realized is the kids are more engaged to videos and can keep watching the same video again and again. And it actually, that's the start of this whole industry of preschool content creators on the YouTube platform. So we still are one of the only enterprise partners out of the APAC region for YouTube worldwide. Our matrix is reach. How do we reach maximum number of kids and make sure that they get safe content which they can actually get entertained and also learn? So we started with English and moved to 12 more languages, which kind of covers majority of the world. So
one query on your business model, do you make money via advertising?
Yes, we make money through ads, yeah.
Okay, so two questions has come to light and feel free to kind of think. So it's your product increases screen time, which is not necessarily what every, maybe especially in families like us, necessarily want. It may be different in certain families. Yeah. Two, it makes money of advertising. So have you ever wondered about the business model? I mean, have there been any dilemmas that you've had, etc.?
So YouTube is responsible for putting the ads.
Got it.
And they are taking care of what kind of advertisers come, and that's where we're kind of taken care of. So in fact, there has been a violation done by YouTube on the COPPA compliant front, and there would probably be restricted ads. No data of the kids would actually be shared. I mean, they cannot collect that kind of data. Mm-hmm. So a lot of cleanup is happening. So when an industry grows really fast, then a lot of regulations fall in. So which is also in a very positive way that the wrong players would actually be pushed out of the business.
Got it. Do you take any steps to kind of restrict screen time if the kid is like continuously watching? I mean, do you have any plans to have that?
No, so we are on a platform which is YouTube. YouTube has also got a platform called YouTube Kids. So in the future, most of the content is going to get consumed on the kids app. So all these things have been built.
Got it.
And within 6 months, you'll see a very different product.
You ideally want, because you're partnering with YouTube and you're on the platform, you'd want the platform to regulate it.
So the platform's
is regulated.
Yeah, that's got what it, is
got it. Thank
but
you.
We also have our own app.
Got it.
Where it's ad-free. So we're looking at what you're saying too.
Okay. Yeah. Maybe getting parents to pay for it or something.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay. Yeah. So I just want to kind of, I did ask Hiten a slightly uncomfortable question, but then we go back a long way. We both worked in the same organization and we're kind of meeting after 10 years on a panel. Yeah.
So there's a different way to look at it.
Yeah.
Whether you like it or not, children are digital natives.
Yeah.
They will pick up the phone and they will look at it, right? Mm. So therefore, it's your ability to give them content that parents are comfortable watching.
Got it.
And kind of controlling it in the way that you said. So for instance, in our app, if they use it beyond 20 minutes, it locks itself. And there is a question which pops up. Unless they answer that question, they can't go to the next one.
Got it.
And for them to answer that question, they have to take parental help. So the parent knows that the child has engaged with it much longer.
Got it.
So this is also an opportunity. And if done in the right way, it increases engagement. It allows you to build personalized learning journeys for children and so on.
Mm. I understand. It's interesting. And these are all dilemmas that we'll navigate through, especially for both of you who are building a consumer-driven brand. So just from a just getting back to both of you, very curious, why did each of you choose the model of, like, why did you look at franchising? And why did Clay look at company-owned? Is there a specific reason why each of you kind of adopted slightly different philosophies to scaling and building?
I think in Clay's case, it was largely to do with the fact that we were not completely convinced that a franchisee could give us uniform outcomes. It's definitely much more scalable in a sense that obviously with franchisees, you could dot India with a lot more centers. But whether we would be able to achieve the same kind of quality or the same kind of experience that a child goes through, whether it be Noida or Chennai, is something that Priya and I personally have our doubts on. And given that I'm a operations hardcore, as we call it, I probably like to keep the control very much in-house. So the training is common, the outcome measurements are fairly standardized, and therefore I think the whole point came about with a uniformity of service delivery and quality being more in our hands, which was what led to the decision to have company-owned, company-operated schools.
I think he correctly shared the concerns, you know. Fortunately, Clay came before us.
Yeah.
So we could actually study both the models. They were large franchise players who had a lot of centers, but as he correctly pointed, there are a lot of quality issues, a lot of standardization issues. And then there was Clay, which was doing great, of course, we respect that. But we were clear that it's not scalable. So we actually thought of a model to combine best of both the worlds. And we thought technology can solve that.
Yeah.
And to exert control, we said instead of having the ownership, what if we control the flow of money? You know, one way to have all the franchises, you know, follow the line is to actually by having all the parents are owned by us, all the standards are defined by us, and we collect all the pay money and then give it to them.
Got it.
One way we found that franchises were not, you know, disobeying the brand or guidelines was because when they had the control, when their centers were full, they wouldn't listen. So we designed the model carefully in a way that we could define the control standards, audits, and through technology, we have the real-time data of every center and everything, so that we can exactly know what's happening in every center. Cameras are there anyway, which parents are watching for their kids, and our auditing teams are watching for the standards being followed in the classrooms.
Got it.
So we kind of could combine both best of both the worlds.
Got it.
Scalability and standardization.
Fair enough. So just want to kind of step back a little bit, and just a quick question, and before that I ask, is there a specific innovation that in your organization that you're proud of? Like just one which has kind of helped you either move on the revenue needle or kind of helped improve outcomes, a specific innovation which you had to pioneer, each of you perhaps?
Yeah. So given that we are a product-led company, yeah, and you're dealing with a very difficult customer who's the child, your ability to hold the child's interest is a key determinant of revenue for us, right? So we enjoy industry-best renewal rates, right? And that has come as a function of continuously iterating on the product. Mm. So if there is something that we are very proud of, it's the fact that we understand the customer really, really well. We understand the design principles really well. And we have reached a stage where we are able to release a product, and we know that by using this product, X percent of renewals will happen, or X percent of repeats will happen, right? So that's kind of, we have iterated
innovation.
Product innovation, product development.
Yes. Hiten, you want to go?
So our aim is to keep building new IPs. So that's something which we keep doing. We use YouTube as our stepping stone, and then we want to graduate to other platforms. And also what we...
Like when you say other platforms, is it like merchandising or is it other revenue streams?
It would be other platforms like maybe Amazon, Netflix.
Got it.
Other broadcast platforms, maybe audio. But the whole intent is to build an IP which is trusted. So a trust is a very, very important factor when it comes to dealing with preschoolers and parents. So once they trust you, they are with you. So even with our partners, if they trust a particular partner, they would keep getting content from
Got
us.
It. Yeah. Shrikant, do you want to just go? Any specific innovation that you're proud of at Clay?
I'd probably not call it innovation as opposed to calling it making use of an opportunity. And the opportunity that presented itself a couple of years ago was the amended Maternity Act bill that came about, which mandated that any workplace with over 50 women will have to provide for childcare within campus or within easy reach from either home or the workplace of the woman. 300 companies in India have contracts with us, so we're largely corporate run in that sense, as in we have tie-ups with corporates where their employees get to use our facilities at negotiated prices. And of course, in many cases, we also run the center inside their premise if they have the space available. I think this pushed up the viability and the revenue model of the business to a
corporate
large extent. The corporate tie-ups, yeah. Yes.
Purvesh?
Yeah. One thing I would say, not like innovation, but the use of technology.
Hmm.
See, in India, unfortunately, educationists, entrepreneurs, and technology people don't talk to each other.
Mm-hmm.
Entrepreneurs don't enter education. Hmm. Educationists don't talk to technology. So we thought, what if we can combine these three and bring them on the same platform?
Got it.
Where by use of the technology, we have all the transparency with the parent, with the franchise partner, teachers, and everyone.
Mm.
So everybody's on the same page. That builds a lot of trust and efficiency.
Got it. Okay, so bringing folks on the same page, and that's okay. All right, so I just want to ask you guys maybe a question around, because this is by Bertelsmann and it's an investor. Some of the challenges, all startups really have two large hats. One is that of growing the business, and the second is fundraising. So from a fundraising perspective, how welcome has been the investor community to some of the initiatives that you've been running? I know you've raised capital from people and Kaizen. You've raised money from RTL. And in your case, you've had 314, Aaron, extra. So given, I mean, I just want to get a sense of, K-12, Byju's, that's a large, big, exciting part of EdTech. This is somewhat the less exciting part of EdTech, not saying, but you know. So in that light, how welcoming has been the investor community? You disagree, I'm sure, but yeah. So how, perhaps I should correct myself, but how welcoming has been the investor community? You want to kind of go first?
So as I said, you know, we were the early entrants. So we were the first partners in the preschool space to get some amount of attention from the investor community. And post that, it was more to do with the operational part of how we could sustain ourselves, because most of the MCNs have actually fallen flat. So we actually learned, we had a strategic partner with RTL, so we've managed to create a business which is sustainable. So I think that's the value add which we've got. Yeah.
So specifically, haven't addressed my question yet. You haven't had any significant challenges in that light. It's because you were the first. There was enough novelty, and there hasn't been any significant competition in that light.
Yeah. So we were also the first Indian network to get funding. So
when got it.
Yeah. So when it comes to a trust factor from another country into India, we had to face that challenge.
Got it.
Which was quite challenging.
Srikant.
I think, as you said, we've been funded twice. We've been funded by Kaizen. We've been funded by People Capital as well. As long as we could demonstrate that there is scalability and that over time the centers mature into a profitable revenue stream, I don't think we've had any issues with the investing community. In fact, we have a tried and tested model where our, you know, more mature network centers, the ones we opened in 2016, 17, 18, have, you know, turned largely profitable. So it's a 6 month to 18 month gestation period when you start a school, and after that it starts taking off.
Got it. Right? So the fact that it is profitable helps convince them.
That's
correct. That the older centers are profitable.
That's correct. That's correct.
Great.
Yeah. For us, investor community has not been welcoming at all.
Wow.
Pranjal, being my batchmate from IIT, Pranjal has given us a lot of guidance, but no money.
Yeah.
So ultimately, we thought, you know, let's bypass the middleman and go directly to people.
All right.
And so we have gone directly to people, and fortunately we are able to sign our franchisees and the parents.
Yeah.
And now we are profitable.
Oh, that's great. It's interesting because franchising is also one way of raising capital. So get somebody else to put in the capital. So fascinating. Okay, so you've had challenges, and I understand. And is it because VCs don't see this as a tech kind of thing, they see this as a service business? Is it because of that? Is it because we don't have enough early stage VCs who are non-tech?
One thing is that. Second thing, I think people had doubts about preschool industry being big enough.
Got it. Mm.
And then definitely, what is the use of technology in preschool?
Mm-hmm.
People kind of don't connect the two.
Uh-huh.
And so far, we haven't been able to explain that, you know, we are primarily a tech play in preschool. But definitely, they don't see tech play. I think third issue is that they don't see scalability.
Got it.
How far it can go? Mm-hmm. Is it only the towns? Can you go to B grade, C grade?
Mm-hmm.
And even the players who scaled before us, there have been, you know, bad stories.
Mm-hmm.
Treehouse was one, you know, Kidzy. Now Eurokids, the transaction has happened, but at what kind of valuations? So I think VCs are kind of scared of taking a bet where the precedence is not very good.
Sure. Well put. Yeah. Vishwanath.
No, I think we've been good. So the investors in Byju's are also investors in us.
Mm-hmm.
I think the key is to seek out investors who buy into the thesis,
which
is what we have done in the past. So we have sought out investors who understand the space, who understand how brands operate, how education companies operate.
Okay.
And that has worked well for us.
You want to just hold it closer? So what's worked for you is seeking the right investor.
Seeking the right kind of investor.
Okay. Fair enough. Did it matter that you were not necessarily seen as tech, pure tech? I mean, was that ever an issue?
It hasn't mattered so far.
Yeah.
So
Tech is a part of our business.
Got it. Tech is a layer.
It's an enabler.
Yeah.
But the key thing is the child loving the product? Is the child learning? Are you generating revenue? Are you generating profits and so on?
Yeah. So we've got 15 more minutes to go. And what I want to do is before maybe open it up to audiences or if there are any more questions, I want to ask one last question. And this is sort of, and maybe what we can do is I'll ask you a question about a very innovative business model that's getting funded in the US and seeing traction. And you can give me your views on that very quickly. And maybe you can
I'll speak of a venture which we ourselves have invested in right now. This is called the London Learning Center, and it's for special needs children. Just as Purvesh mentioned that up to the age of 5, you see a lot of development in the child's brain, it's also clear that there are certain milestones, clinically prescribed milestones, that children have to go through in the first 5 years. While that form, the clinical form, is very well outlined, the government does not have any such outlining for preschools as to whether preschools are reaching these milestones or not. Now, good preschools like Footprints, like Clear, like a handful of others actually do take care of these milestones. One of the things we noticed was just like for a normal child, even for a special needs child, early intervention is extremely crucial. So we actually invested in a company that deals with early intervention for special needs children. And we're trying to set them up as a school-in-school concept. So we have 4 up to now. We have plans of expanding it through about 25 across India.
That's fascinating.
Where we'll be addressing the needs of special needs children who are identified in the course of their journey with us.
Got it. No, that's interesting, yeah. So probably a good time to kind of open it up, and if folks have any questions here, we've had questions. I think everybody wants to hear Vivek.
Vivek is already here. Yeah. Everybody is waiting for Vivek to come in.
So, So everybody wants Vivek Oberoi. Nobody wants. There you go. Yeah. So great. Thank you so much. I think it's been an interesting discussion and certainly given me some ideas. And thank you so much. Thank you, Vishwanath.
Thank you.
Gurvesh, AK, and Yogendra. Sorry, Hitendra. Great.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thanks, everyone.